Hello all together to the Powtech Virtual Talks on drying. The first topic will be basic of spray drying and possible applications in pharma, chemical and hard metal industry from GEA. Gunter Philipp and Ole Flint will talk. Enjoy the talks and empower yourself. Thank you.
Hello, everybody, again. Hopefully, we can catch up a little time. I have a number of slides, and I do start with the agenda. I will have a very short introduction on GEA Group. For those which don't know that, then we talk about spray drying basics, which consists of atomization, evaporation, particle forms, particle size, product recovery, plant design due to safety. You will learn this later what it means, because safety details will drive the later design of a plant. Single pass versus closed cycle is also part of it. We talk about applications, as Frau Rudner already mentioned, chemical, hard metal, and pharmaceutical. I will explain a little bit more in detail, not too much. And at the beginning of my presentation, I will also show what I will not go into depths, because this is not my particularly area. Then we can talk about plant types and sizes and R&D in our company, which has a few interesting things, and we're bringing technology forward continuously. But maybe we have to swap this when time might not be sufficient. I will do this very short. Here, at a glance, you see about our order intake, the number of employees, and what is this? These figures are based on 2019, so we don't have yet the figures from this year. We also started the year with a new organization, which is more dedicated to our clients, and also sharing our different technologies. The part Ole Flint and I'm working for is the liquid and powder technologies, and it's interesting because what we say is we turn liquid into powder with spray drying. And this liquid and powder technologies division is much smaller. It's 5,500 employees, and you see also the revenue in this part. Apart from the powder technologies itself, it's also is liquid technologies, beverages and filling technologies, and chemical technologies. This is not so sharp differentiated, but for some historical reasons, we are still in this sort of group. It's not so easy to organize a big organization like GEA. It's getting more easy when I talk about GEA Process Engineering AS, which is the company name for what we call GEA Niro, because Niro is an original part. And it was founded in 1933 by a man called Johanne Nyrup, and he had the impression that Nyrup is too difficult to spell in the rest of the world, and therefore he called his company Niro. And we have about 600 employees in our headquarters in Copenhagen, and worldwide about 1,500. We have more than 10,000 references. We have a very large test center. You might see a picture later. And we do a lot of R&D. And of course, we are active globally. Now, these applications, which I'm not the expert for, because I have two colleagues which cover this. We have one colleague who is covering dairy, and another colleague is covering food products and milk. Instant coffee is a very big product. We do a lot of with flavors and vitamins. Tomato soup is, for example, or what's in recent times coming up more and more is proteins made of various natural resources and many, many more. We do small spray dryers, but we do also big ones. Okay, a table to compare various drying methods. And since the title is thermal sensitive products, there are two drying methods which are good for thermal sensitive products. This is the first one is lyophilization, and the other one is spray drying. And why spray drying is good for drying of thermal sensitive products, I will show during the presentation later. But also lyophilization is a good method. But you see, there is also some downsides. There is a long drying time, and you need deep temperatures. This means that lyophilization normally is more expensive than spray drying. But still, for example, strawberries, like you find in your muesli, we are not still able to do it with spray drying. We still have to do it with lyophilization. The process of specialization, which happens in a drying chamber, and it can be done with nozzles or with rotary atomizers. The nozzles itself are two different types. This is where the feed goes in and is atomized, and then we need the drying gas, which comes via a filter and a heater as hot air, or can also be hot nitrogen, for example. Then the particles and the air go through this chamber, and here the liquid turns into powder because the solvent is evaporating. Sorry. And then the powder comes out together with a gas stream, and the particles have to be recovered from the gas stream. This is often done by a cyclone and the back filter and or. We start with atomization. I mentioned already there is different nozzles, and very well known is a two-fluid nozzle, where we use compressed air or compressed nitrogen. You see 3 to 80 microns is a typical particle size we can achieve. These are very small particles. The alternative is a pressure nozzle. I must say the energy for atomization with a two-fluid nozzle comes from the compressed gas. The pressure nozzle itself does not need gas, but it works with a high pressure, typically 40 bars or whatever, and the energy is the high pressure. And if it's released from this nozzle, then you get the atomized droplets. The typical particle size you can achieve is 20 to 200 micron. Very nice, the pressure nozzle has a very narrow particle size distribution. And then there is a third method, which we use quite often. It's called rotary atomizer. It's a rotating disc which turns with a very high speed, and the feed comes in and is distributed via this rotating disc. So the energy comes from this rotation of the disc. And we can make particles in a large range from 20 to 300 microns. This curve does show with the same particle, medium particle size of D50 of 50 micron, And you can see for the various methods how the distribution is, and the pressure nozzle, as I said just before, as the narrowest, and the two fluid nozzle has always this tail to the small particles. Now it's getting exciting. Why is spray drying so smooth? This slide shows what happens. We start the atomization of the feed, and then we have a temperature raise until the water or the solvent starts to evaporate, and then we get in this constant phase, which is called wet bulb phase, where the free solvent is evaporating. In the next phase, the solvent is not free anymore. It's binded to the particle, and then it needs a little bit more temperature. At the end, at the dry bulb phase, the particles are leaving the dryer or the chamber, and the secret is that our residence time is very short, 0.5 for a very small dryer, up to 30 seconds, but this is already a very big dryer. So the thermal impact of drying is very limited. We also get various shapes of particles. And you see the different names. This depends, of course, on the behavior of the product itself. Most common is the sinosphere, and maybe it's getting a bit more with this electronic microscope pictures. You see that in reality it's really the case. This is what we don't like, because we have this hollow shape, and these particles are not easy to handle, and the most common, as I said, are the sinosphere ones. How do we get the product out? This was mentioned already before. We have here the drying chamber. We go with an airstream via a cyclone. There we collect most of the products. Then we have a bag filter where we can get also fine material out, and the gas is normally leaving without particles. We can have also the version where we only apply a bag filter. This is always done when we have very small particles, which cannot be separated in a cyclone. And we have a version where we have very heavy particles, which come out of the chamber, and more finer products can come out of a cyclone and the bag filter. So you see, it depends always on the material, how we deal with that. We are doing always development, and we also, we thought a cyclone cannot be improved, but we made a major survey and spent a lot of work improving cyclones with a great success, I must say. And one of the key methods was this computational fluid dynamics, which allowed us to design a new cyclone. And if you, instead of 95% yield, if you can achieve 98%, you get 3% extra with no extra cost. And this is really something which our clients do appreciate. I mentioned also the bag filter, which often comes behind the cyclone, because the cyclone has a border. It works on centrifugal forces, and if the particles are getting too small and too much airborne, then you cannot remove it, and then you need this bag filter. The bags are normally from outside to the inside. The gas goes through, and the small particles stay here. At the same time, you get a pressure increase, and at a certain point you blow it back, the powder falls down, and then you start again, and normally you have a number of bags in a bag filter, and one bag does blow back after the other. At the beginning, I said, okay, the feed and the hot gas, they are going the same direction, which we call co-current flow. This is the normal way to do it. Sometimes we do it in a different way. The hot air comes in here and the feed comes from the bottom. This has a big advantage. We spray upwards and the particles move downwards, so we increase the retention time. But of course, these droplets are meeting not the hot air, but the already cooled air. And during the journey, they reach the hottest point. This means this method is not possible for heat-sensitive products. It's a mixed flow at the end. And there is a third version. We can also have a fluidized bed in the bottom in order to increase particle size, because we have some agglomeration down here. So, safety considerations. This is why we often have to, we often get inquiries. Could you please give us a price for a spray dryer? We have so and so many kilo per hour, and please give us a price. And then we always have to go back and ask a number of questions, because you see on the right side five different principles of running a spray dryer. And the first question is, can you have a gas explosion? If the answer is yes, because the feed contains organic solvents, then we have normally to work with nitrogen in order to save the nitrogen in the amount. We go in a closed cycle, but we also can go in one through. In some cases, if depends on the explosion data, we can also go one through with an explosion suppression installed. If we don't have a gas explosion, the next question is, do we have oxidation? If the answer is yes, we have to go to an inert atmosphere. Again, we have to go to nitrogen. But if we have no oxidation and no gas explosion and no oxidation, then still we still can have a dust explosion with the dried particles. If the powder air mixture can explode, we have the four first possibilities we can go for. Normally we go for this one. We have an explosion panel which does disappear in the very rare case of an explosion, because still also with a dust explosion you need a spark to initiate. And only if even the powder is not explosive, we can just go with air once through. This is why we always have to ask these questions, with sometimes our clients say, "Ah, okay, now we need to know all this stuff." I mentioned already a single pass, and this is what we show here. It's in this case, we have, the air comes in. We have an electric heater. In this case, we have a HEPA filter. This is normally for pharmaceutical applications. Then we have the drying chamber where the feed comes in. We have the cyclone, the back filter, and the HEPA filter in this case to go out. And in this case, we also have two fans. The opposite, more or less, is a closed cycle where the gas is recirculated in order to use not much inert gas like nitrogen. There we have to have a condenser in which removes the evaporated solvent. Now I come to the applications. And the chemical applications are really wide. My colleagues from dairy, they always dry milk. It's always the same process, more or less. We have, of course different milks, but the majority is cow milk, and this means it's always the same process. For my applications, almost every spray dryer is different to the other because we have so many products and in so many varieties. I will mention from the whole of the chemical applications, I will go mention two things, which are battery materials and the other one are hard metals, as announced. This is what we do with lithium ion battery material. We have a strong requirement for very small particles. So these clients want to have very small particles, 4 to 7 micron, you can see here, and at the same time, a very small span. And this was not possible to achieve with the standard methods on the market. Therefore, we had to develop a special device. We call it Combi Nozzle. It's a nozzle which was particularly developed for small particles. Some examples of chemical plants and of rotary atomizer. This one is our smallest. It runs with a speed up to 60,000 RPM. But we also have big ones, and they have also a record figure because it's a driving power. It's up to 1,000 kilowatts. So such a rotary atomizer for a huge plant can have up to 1 megawatt drive. This is quite impressive. Hard metal, we already have seen a closed cycle. For hard metals, we often have organic solvents together with tungsten carbide, very often is used. These metals are applied for all cutting tools and so on machines. This is how a spray dryer or two spray dryer in this case does look like with closed cycle, with organic solvents and to produce tungsten carbide. Now pharmaceutical applications. There is a number of possible applications. First of all, you can produce APIs, active pharmaceutical ingredients with spray drying in the desired particle form and size. You can make, you know, people who, I don't know what people I'm listening now, but people from the pharmaceutical industry know that all the solid forms are made more or less as a granulation and then a tablet or a pellet for a capsule. And the granulation is done in a spray granulation or a high shear mixer. You can also put all your ingredients and your excipients together in 1 feet and make a direct compressibility product, which you can put in your tablet press directly. You can produce particles which are already have a modified release, or for taste masking. So yes, in order to release the API in a slow way or whatever, or protect it against the stomach acid and so on. Then products for inhalation. This is partly a similar application, like the small particles for battery cells, because for inhalation you need also particles below 6 micron aerodynamic diameter in order that they can reach the deep lung. And a couple of years ago there was a big hype for having inhalable insulin, and we worked with all these companies who supplied that. You can also do aseptic production. For example, you can produce vaccines. Here we are in competition with lyophilization, because some aseptic products are not stable in solution, and therefore you produce a powder which is dissolved by the doctor before it's applied. And what's also often done is increased bioavailability. If the solubility of an API is very poor, it often comes from its crystal form. And for this reason, we produce an amorphous form, which is stabilized with a polymer. And then you increase a higher bioavailability for the body. This is what we do in pharmaceutical spray drying. And of course, a spray dryer, you have seen pictures of a chemical spray dryer. A spray dryer for pharmaceutical does look different with all this shiny and nicely polished equipment. And you have to work under so-called GMP conditions. The first one was our smallest, the PSD1, and this is a PSD4. We also have a division between gray room and production room. An increasing demand comes mainly from pharma, but also from other industries for containment. For this, we also have strategies how to apply this. We, for example, the first, which we call potent materials, we normally work with on the interfaces with split valves, for example. And we do a wetting before we open the plant for the high potent material down to 1 microgram per cubic meter. We have a different concepts, which we call API. And this works with pressure differences from the outside to the inside. We work with isolators, HEPA filters, and so on. And on the right side, you see an example of a HEPA filter back-in, back-out system. One slide about the types and sizes. I believe I'm well in time, so I can show you also the rest. We start with our smallest, the mobile miner, which is called as a pharma execution, a PSD1, and our order is always to state the amount of drying gas. And you see this increases with the size, and you see also some correspondence between this figure and this figure. The pharma size, the standard sizes end with PSD6, but above it's also possible to have pharma spray dryers. They are then individually engineered. And it's about the same, the largest standard spray dryer work with 200,000 kilo per hour of air. This is a really big one. But this is not the limit. We can also do bigger ones, which are then individually engineered. Just an example, how our, this is the most sold spray dryer in the world, and it changed over the years. This is the latest model on the right side, and to give you an idea, about 2,500 of these mobile miners we sold over the years. We have in Copenhagen a test station with 35 test plants of different drying methods, but the majority is spray dryers. We do some analytics, as you can see on the right side. And we do also some research and development. And part of this test station is also a pharma test station where we can work under more or less GMP conditions. We had approval by the Danish government for production of a clinical batch material and also production of pharma material, but we gave this up because it's not this concept doesn't allow too much flexibility, and there are enough contract manufacturers around. And now something, I hope this works, which you might have not seen. This is an example what we do in R&D. We developed something which we call Trinetics. And this means we put one droplet into a machine, and we use this droplet is freely moving in a above a nozzle, and we try one droplet. Okay, it doesn't work, obviously. So I can explain. This droplet does try, and we get a figure of a trying curve of one droplet. We can pick one droplet and can see also morphology, stickiness, size, and so on. And with this figure and or with this data, we can apply a CFD simulation and can make a prediction how particles move with what speeds, temperatures, and so on within the spray dryer. And you get these nice results. And these results are very, very good for optimizing geometry and the process itself. And together with only using one droplet, of course, for very expensive stuff, particularly in pharma, again, this is a method which is which our clients do like very much. So I'm coming to the end. This is a two-dimensional pictures of CFD. You can do really a lot. You see the temperature distribution. This has to do with a smooth drying, because it's only one phase which is very hot, and then eventually you have evaporation, which means the rest of the dryer is not so critical. So I'm on the end now. Going back and ending my sharing. So hopefully you could hear everything and could see everything.
Yes. Thank you.
Okay.
Perfect. Thank you. Great. And I will hand over to Ulla Ortner. I'm sure she has some questions. And perhaps you all there have also questions. So you can ask your questions in the chat. I'm trying to manage them. Ms. Ortner?
Yes, I just see the first question in the chat. But before that, I want to ask one question, which is very, I was particularly interested in the possibilities spray drying overs for APIs and for other pharmaceutical products. How long has the method been used in the pharmaceutical industry, and how many references GEA NIO can already provide?
The use of in the pharmaceutical goes back a long time, but it was always a special field, and only say in the last 20 years we saw a huge increase because people discovered pharmaceutical, you know, is a very conservative industry. Yes. And they had their methods as I described it with granulation, and but more and more they see opportunities to do things which are not possible with other processes. The number we have a number, but it's not Ole Flint, do you know Ole, the number of pharmaceutical applications we have supplied. I know I have it somewhere in a presentation, but I can't recall it right now.
Can you hear me?
Yeah, perfect.
Excellent. I solved the problem with the microphone in the meantime. Number of references, as Gunda Philip has mentioned, has gone up considerably over the last 20 years. And today it's around it's around 200 installations worldwide in the pharmaceutical industry. Not all of these are the sizes you have seen in some of the pictures, because the pharmaceutical processes are typically smaller volumes and smaller batches. You saw the chart before, and typically the sizes are between PSD1 to PSD4, so up to 1250 kilos of drying gas rates. And some of the biggest pharmaceutical, dedicated pharmaceutical plants are around size 200 or so. So these are still considerable in size, but not compared to dairy industry.
We have three more questions. Mr. Kockel was the first one to ask a question.
I can read it, one question. After trying champ.
Mr. Kockel is asking, he's one question on the form of the drying chamber. What is, Mr. Kockel, you could also talk if you would like, or if it's not, because I can't see your question really.
The drying chamber has this form with a cone on the bottom, and you like to have a certain angle of this cone in order that the powder does not sit there. Therefore, all the spray dryers look a bit the same. They have this cone, which is steep enough that the powder doesn't sit there. And then the powder normally, either it leaves with the air to a cyclone, or if it's very heavy and big particles, they can also leave on the cone. I don't know if this answers the question exactly.
So, Mr. Kockel, I hope this answers your question. He's writing, is there a specific radial between the cylindrical and the conical section?
I don't know by heart the angle, but it needs to be steep enough. This depends also on the experience of the manufacturer and, of course, mainly on the product itself. There is some experience the manufacturers made, and this is what we apply normally. And we have, in addition, we also have knockers outside, which prevent powder building up there. And the powder itself, of course, is very different. It's always problematic if you have a sticky powder, which tends to stay on surfaces. And it's always also difficult if you have very small particles, because due to the van der Waals forces and so on, you have a tendency that they stick to surfaces everywhere. If you know lab spray dryers like a Büchi with glass, this is normally even worse, because the glass is electric, not conductive. Normally we have metal chambers, and this effect is a little bit less problematic there. I don't know if this answer is sufficient.
So we have a few more questions, and yeah, we are running a bit of time. So because of that, Mr. Kockel, if you need more information, it's no problem to contact Mr. Philip directly or us. So we will refer your question. Mr. Becker is asking a question here. What is maximum viscosity for liquid solution pharma food for automation?
It's not only viscosity, but viscosity is a good point. What we normally say is quite simple. Your feet need to create droplets. If this doesn't happen, then spray drying is not possible. And if you ask now what it's not creating droplets, it's, for example, honey, which is not nice to atomize. You can't spray dry honey. And the viscosity depends also a little bit on the. I don't have an absolute value, but we normally give recommendations how high the viscosity could be. Sometimes we even heat up the feed for this reason, and there's a number of details you can do.
Perfect. Then Mr. Appel is having a question. If you are developing new technologies according to their customer requirements?
Yes and no. We cannot, of course, not do for every product, we cannot do a particular design, but I would guess that the vast majority, 98% of the products will fit in our standard, in our normal standard. You have seen the slide with 35 installations in our test center, and you can imagine this is the reason why we have this test center. If a customer comes and say, okay, I want to spray dry this particular product, then we normally start with a small scale sample test, and we find out things like I mentioned before. Is it to be atomized? Is it crystallizing? Is it forming a powder? And then we have the opportunity to do a number of tests in different sizes. And normally the customer gets away with figures how to spray dry his product. And yeah, of course, we have a huge database of products we already tested. So in many, many cases, we have already the knowledge. But also with the same product, you might have different particle sizes and different whatever. It can vary a lot. But yeah, it's not sometimes it's difficult. Yeah, it's not an easy technology to apply. We need to know a lot, and we need also to learn during a project a lot.
Okay, so I know there are a few more questions, but we are really a bit running out of time. I would really ask you a lot to contact Mr. Philip or Mr. Flynn for all belongings and or us, of course. And I would like to end this here. I hope it's okay. Mr. Philip, thank you very much for your presentation. It was really great. I would, ask Ms. Lee to come in and hand over to Ms. Reutner, because she's telling you a bit more about Dr. Lee. Thank you, Mr. Philip.
Yeah, thank you very much for listening. And you're thank welcome you. To contact me, of course.
Thank you.
Thank you. I think it works well via LinkedIn if you want to contact Gunter Philipp or Olli Flint.